two things. One is magnetic field. One is magnetic field. Next is conductor. Magnetic field and conductor. These are the basic two things to produce the EMF as per Faraday's law. So, in cycle dynamo, I hope everyone see that cycle dynamo. The cycle dynamo will generate the cycle dynamo, which is used is a simple example for the DC generator. In the dynamo, we have a magnetic field. Suppose you may open that cycle dynamo. If you open the dynamo, we have a two permanent magnet like this in the cycle dynamo. In the cycle dynamo, so imagine that. Imagine that we have a conductor, and this part, this is a one north pole and this is a south pole. So we place the conductor in between the north pole and south pole. So in cycle dynamo, we have a permanent magnet. So we have a permanent magnet in the cycle dynamo. So the permanent magnet, which is represent the magnetic field, and this is a conductor which is rotate in the cycle dynamo, and we get the two wires in the bottom, such that we get the electricity from that conductor. So that we get the electricity from the conductor. So Faraday's law say that we get the electricity from the conductor, and this is the portion. If we rotate this is the portion we put in that cycle tire, which is rotated. So we rotate the magnet. So imagine that this is a magnetic field. This is the magnetic field, and this conductor rotate. This conductor rotate means it cut the magnetic field. So that's why this conductor experienced the EMF. So just we discuss in the diagram construction detail. So here this is an example for the four pole DC machine. So imagine that if it's a two pole synchronous machine, so we have a north pole and south pole. We discuss about the cycle dynamo. So first we are discussing about magnetic field. So these are the poles. These are the poles, and we put a winding in the pole, and we give the external DC supply to generate a constant magnetic field. In cycle dynamo, we are using the permanent magnet. In general, in the DC motor, we connect to a separate DC supply, as we discussed in that. So I hope mostly we are. Suppose you are working in the construction field, you have a SLD, we have a DG. In DG, we provide the battery. The battery is a source to provide the power supply to the magnet, magnetic field, to create the magnetic field. Constant magnetic field. So we put a DC supply to the winding, and we get a constant magnetic field. And so our objective is to create the constant magnetic field. That's why we go for the winding. We need the winding in the core. So that's why we go for the pole. This is winding, and we go for the pole. And we need a support for the pole. That's why we go for the yoke. So this yoke is a mechanical support for the pole. And the construction of the yoke is a cylindrical one. So we need the base, because it is a cylindrical, is circular one or cylindrical one is not stand on the flat surface. So that's why we need a base. So to avoid the vibration, so we have a hole here to fix in the base. And another thing, here we are using the binding. So to create the magnetic field, we are using the binding, and we give the battery power supply. So we need a terminal box. So here we have a terminal box in the. So in the terminal box, we give the DC supply for the winding. So these are the parts for the magnetic field, because we need two things. One is the magnetic field, another is the conductor. Now we are discussing about the conductor. So conductor, already I said, conductor which is help to convert the mechanical energy to electrical energy. So conductor is a rotating part. If a conductor is a rotating part, we need a bearing. We need a support to stand there. So what we said, that we need a, this is a conductor, it is we rotate, so we need a staff, and we put the bearing. Just a minute. So conductor, this is the conductor rotate, so we need a support to stand the conductor. So this support we call as a, in the this support we put a bearing to free rotations. Point number one. So in electrically we say that it is a conductor. It's a conductor with shaft. With a shaft and bearing. And it's a conductor. Here we are assuming a single conductor. So depends upon the, suppose if you need a high voltage, we increase the number of turns. Let me discuss in that second Faraday's second law. So in general, if you generate a high voltage, we increase the number of turns, or we increase the speed. So I hope you may experience in the cycle dynamo, if you pedal the cycle is at low speed, the bulb glow lightly. If we increase the speed, the bulb glows bright, with a high brightness. That is, if the speed increases, the intensity of the light is increased. That means the voltage is increased. So from this, we can say that EMF is directly proportional to speed. N is number of, not a number of conductor, it is speed. So E is directly proportional to speed. It is a mechanical parameter. So we electrical engineers, now we are discussing about the electrical parameters. So next, E is directly proportional to, is directly proportional to number of conductors in the number of conductors in that armature winding, that is in this winding here, number of conductors. So it is a rotate and we get the power supply from this conductor. So it's a rotating part, and imagine that we have two fingers are there. Now I put this here. So this, we get the power supply from these two fingers. So I put it like this. So now the conductor is rotate. Conductor is rotate. We get the power supply from these two fingers that we represent here. This part. This is called a brush. So later we are using one another term, we call it a commutator. But from this conception, just imagine that these two fingers are the brushes to get the power supply, to get the power supply from the conductor winding. So that terminal, that two wires, these two wires from the connected to the terminal box. So here we suppose maybe we have four terminals are there. Four terminals, two for input supply to the magnetic field, two supply for the conductor. So hereafter we say that the magnetic field we call as a field winding, and conductor we call as armature winding. So that is, this system we call as a field winding. This system we call as a field winding, and this system we call as a armature winding. So armature winding represent, as per Faraday's law, armature winding represent conductor, and field winding represent magnetic field. So the magnetic field is maybe a constant magnetic field or variable magnetic field. If it is constant magnetic field, we are, is the example for the DC generator. If it is a variable magnetic field, this is represent the transformer. So these are the things we are discussing in this construction. Yoke, poles, pole shoe. So rest of the things are there. So working principle of the DC generator. Once again, I explained with some diagrams. So according to the Faraday's law, whenever a conductor is placed in a variable magnetic field or conductor is moved in the magnetic field. So here, whenever a conductor placed in a variable magnetic field, so variable magnetic field means here is the example for the transformer. So in the transformer, the secondary winding is placed in the variable magnetic field, because in that transformer, the primary winding, the magnetic field is a time dependent, because we are giving that DC AC supply to the primary winding. So that's why the magnetic field is vary with respect to the time. Or for DC generator, we go for the second line. A conductor is moved in a magnetic field. The DC generator, we have a constant magnetic field instead of variable magnetic field in the transformer. We have a constant magnetic field, and we play the conductor is moved in the magnetic field. Here, the conductor and magnetic field are stationary, so it's a static device. Here, the magnetic field is static because and this conductor is a moving part. So that's why this generator we call as a dynamic device, that is rotating device. So induced EMF can be calculated from the EMF equation of the DC generator from second law. If the conductor closed, if it is rotated, it generate EMF only. If you connect the brushes and this brushes connected to that lamp, it is a closed circuit. It flows the current. So when we discuss in that first section, the circuit is closed. Yeah, current will flow. So field winding produces the magnetic field. Armature winding is a rotating part. So as we discussed, we have a north pole, south pole. So just this finger as a north pole and this finger as a south pole. So in between these two fingers, we have a So imagine that we have a south pole, north pole, these two fingers, two hands, and these lines are the magnetic flux lines that we represent in this. These are the magnetic lines. And we have a, now for understanding, I have a single turn and this and this is called as A, B, C, D. So imagine that now this conductor is like this, and at rotating the conductor become like this at that time. So now you say that we have two lines are there. So this conductor cuts all the magnetic field. So that's why this is A, B, C, D. During that, so now this is A, B, C, D. Now this rotate. So the A, B is the upward direction. If the A, B is upward direction, at that time it cuts the all the four fingers. It cut all the four fingers. That is, it cut the all the magnetic field. So that's why it produces the maximum EMF. Now the conductor is rotate like this. So instead of four fingers, it's cut only three fingers and two fingers, and it is parallel to the conductor. There is no EMF induced in the conductor. So if the conductor parallel to the magnetic field, There is no EMF induced in the conductor. And once again, you rotate. Now the conductor A, B, now in the upward directions, that now downward direction. In the upward direction, the current flow direction is one direction, and in the downward direction, the direction is changed. So that we discuss in the line. So EMF equation of the DC generator depends upon the Faraday's second law. Faraday's second law. Rate of change of electric. The Faraday's second law states, the magnitude of induced EMF E is equal to rate of change of flux linkages, as we discussed in the transformer, the same principle, because both the transformer and the DC electrical machines working on the same principle, the same second law is applicable for the DC generators also. So E is equal to rate of change of flux linkages. The only difference is in the transformer, we are using that the transformer, the flux is a variable quantity. Here the flux is a constant quantity. And in the transformer, the primary winding, the secondary winding is not denoted. So that's the basic difference between the Faraday's transformers and DC generator. So anyhow, the magnitude for the induced EMF is rate of change of flux linkages. So based with respect to that construction of DC generator, so we have a pi flux per pole. So as already we have so here 1, 2, 3, 4 poles are there. So number of poles. So that's why we write that number of poles. So number of poles, and each pole produce pi flux. Pi, the unit for the flux is Weber. So these two things are represent the magnetic, represent from the field winding. Next we go to that armature winding, that is conductor part. So the conductor, we have a Z number of conductors are there. We have a Z number of conductors are there. So these two things are related to the field winding, and these terms are related to the armature winding. This is field winding, and this part is mechanical quantity. Is the speed of the conductor. It depends upon our requirement, and this quantity is a output quantity where we get that. So these are the units we are used in the EMF equation. So once again, as per second Faraday second law, induced EMF of E is equal to d pi by dt. E is equal to d pi by dt. D pi is flux cut, and dt is equal to time taken for the rotation of the conductor. So first we discussing about the flux linkages. Flux linkages per conductor in one revolution. So this is a conductor. Suppose if you take as a reference, if it is a reference, if it is a reference, this is rotate for one revolution. If the conductor rotates for one revolution, it cuts the conductor one, so pole 1, 2, 3, 4. So for full revolutions, it cut 4. Suppose if you have a each pole is having a pi flexes, pi flex for one revolution is cut 4 pi. So that we discuss in the so that's why flux cut per conductor in one revolution is pi number of poles, because in the drawing we find 4 pi. 4 is represent here, sorry, pi is represent the pi, and p number of poles here. In our construction we using 4 pole, so that's why 4 pi. So first thing, next, number of revolution per second, n is equal to speed in rpm. So number of revolution per, this is wrong, it is wrong, it is number of seconds. Please change, I will change that slide. Number of revolution per second, number of revolution per minute is n, number of revolution per second or PS is small n, which is equal to n by 60, because in SI unit in the number of revolution we represent the seconds. So number of revolution per second is n by 60. So d pi is pi into p, and dt is 60 n. So you substitute this two equation, this is equation number 1, equation number 2, equation number 3, substitute 2 and 3 in 1, we get pi p n by 60. This is the generated EMF per conductor. Once again, it is a generated EMF per conductor. So total EMF generated between the terminal, that is number of conductors, E is equal to average induced EMF per conductor, is the number of conductor in each parallel path. So this is, this we call as a conductor 1, this is conductor 2. So for each turn we have a 2 conductors, so we have a, so this A, so depends upon the lap winding and wave winding, we have a different things are there that we discuss later. This is because depend whenever we have some problems at that time we are discussing about the late binding and way binding. So in our exam they didn't ask about the what is the late binding way binding. So here we have a formula. So generate average EMF this value and number of conductors per parallel path we have a Z by A. So multiply this we get this EMF equation. So we need to by your this equation E is equal to pi P n by 60 into Z by A. So generated EMF. So we have first thing we are discussing about the law, Faraday's law, then conduction, then working principle, and how much EMF induced from the EMF equation we are generated. We are generated this much of EMF. So these two things I will discuss in this later because okay. Now classification of a DC machines. Just a minute. Hello, are you hear my voice?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay.
Yes, yes, we can hear you. Yeah.
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Now we are go to the classification of the DC machines. So DC machines, because now we are discussing about the DC generator, the construction of the DC generator as well as DC motors are almost same. So similarly, the classification of the DC generator and DC motors almost the same. Now we are discussing about the classification of the DC machines. So the classification is based on the field winding. That is, as per Faraday's law, we have two things are there. One is the magnetic field, another is the conductor. The magnetic field we call as a field winding. That field winding, more technically we call as excitation. So the classification is based on the excitation. That is classification. Sorry, classification based on the field winding. That is the field winding. Either the field winding may be a permanent magnet. As we discuss in the cycle dynamo, we are using that permanent magnet. Number one, number two. Sometimes we are using that separately excited. That is in the field winding. Separately, we provide the DC supply. This is we are used in the construction. In the construction, we have a DC generator. almost in a in the construction field, we have a DC generator. In the DC generator, just see around the DC generator. In the one particular, they put a plus and minus, and in below that they have a one DC battery. So that is a separately excited DC generator. This is the so one is we are using the permanent magnet. Another is one is here if we provide the power supply from the external source. Is number two. Number three is a self-excited generator. This field winding generator the self-excited generator having a field winding. That field winding itself having a voltage. Let me discuss in that circuit. Let me discuss in that next slides. So that's why here we have forgot about the permanent magnet. So we have two things are there. One is a separately excited and self-excited. Separately excited field windings are energized from the independent external DC source. We see in our construction sites. So self-excited generator. So once again, the self-excited generator is classified. The self-excited generator is classified based on the connections. Based on the connections, which one we have two windings are there. One is a field winding, another is a armature winding. So we have a either field winding or armature winding. Depends upon the connections between the field winding or armature winding. We classify into three major categories. One is a series wound generator. series wound generator, shunt wound and com wound wind. In simply we say that series generator, shunt generator, com wound generator. And the com wound generator, we have subdivisions are there. Let me discuss one by one. This is separately excited generator. So in the name itself, this is a field winding. We have a separate. This field winding, we have a separate DC supply. So that is this field winding generate a constant magnetic field, and we put here this generator and put here an armature winding and put your armature winding in this field. That is, if you provide a DC supply, we have a field winding. Now this armature winding placed in the magnetic field. So this is and this armature winding is rotate, which means this armature conductor cuts the magnetic field and we get the DC supply. And general. Separately excited generator we are using in that research applications, and in our exam point of view we must and this is too important speed control of DC generator as well as DC speed control of DC motor. Accurate speed control, we are using that burn load system is too important. Speed control of a DC motor is burn load system. It is too important. They may ask in the exam, in the UPSC exam, they may ask for accurate speed control. We are using. We are using Bernoulli method. Next, we go to the separately excited DC machines. separately actuated DC machines. Here, in the field winding, we have some we have some fluxes present in the field winding, which we call as a residual magnetism. So once again, in the previous class, we discussed about the transient circuit. Here, for a transient circuit, we discuss about this one. Okay. Here, in the DC generator, our output is a induced EMF. So in general, output always in the y axis, so it is a EMF E. In the x axis is a dependent variable. Who is the cause to produce the EMF? We need E is directly proportional to speed and pi. Just we discuss in the So from this equation, E is directly proportional to pi, and P is a constant. You ruled out. N is a mechanical. N mechanical parameter, and Z and A is a number of conductors is also fixed, and 60 is a constant. So E is directly proportional to pi and N. Okay, but N is a mechanical parameter. It is ruled out. So induced EMF is directly proportional to the flux. So this is the induced. In the transient circuit, we discuss like this. With respect to time, this is a curve for the I of t. Here, this R and L represent the armature winding. So, this is pi, and this is induced EMF E. If pi increases, induced EMF increases. So this is the curve for the separately excited generator. For self-excited generator, initially this winding having some magnetic field, so that we represent here. So once again, here we have one question. In self-excited generator, we have a residual magnetic field. In self-excited generator and self-excited DC motor, we have a residual magnetic field in the field winding, not in the armature winding, in the field winding. It is another question in the UPDA. Here we have a series field winding. series bounded DC machines, or simply we say that series. Here we are discussing about a generator, so DC generator. So the DC generator, this represents the field winding, and this is represent here armature winding. These two windings are connected in series connection. That's why we call it a DC series motor generator. Number one. Number two, important. We have two or three important questions in the UPDA exam. So in general, the armature winding, that is this winding, carries induced EMF. Okay, so the armature winding carry a armature current IA, and the field winding is connected in series with the armature winding. So in the series circuit, current same. So IF is a field winding current. Here I represent as IFSE. F stands for field winding. SE stands for series field winding. So in DC series generator, armature winding and field winding carries the same current. Okay, if load increases, because we connect the, it's a DC generator, so we connect the load here. We connect the external load. So because it is a DC generator, the output is electrical energy. The electrical energy is connected to some particular load. If load increases, the current also increases. So which is equal to IL. If load increases, load current increases, and all are series connection. So field winding, armature winding, all the currents are increases. Okay, number. Now, if IL increases, IFSE increases. If ISE increases, voltage drop in the field winding increases. Okay, because voltage drop is here. Voltage drop V is equal to I into R. I here IFSE R resistance, shunt field winding resistance RSE. Okay. Once again, here we have a generated EMF EG, because is a generator, is produce a induced EMF. That's induced EMF, we represent EG, which is equal to, the EG is connected to the load, so it's a terminal voltage. So you forget about the load. So EG, which is equal to voltage drop in the field winding. Here we have a series field winding, so that's why VSE, and voltage drop in the sorry. So the armature winding generated EMF. So E, which is equal, because this is the source, which is equal to the voltage is flow from the winding and the load. So VSE plus VL. If the voltage drop in the series welding is increased, means the voltage drop, the output of the load, we have a less voltage. So our objective is to design the field winding less voltage drop. We need a less voltage drop. That is I, S, E, R, E. So ISC is not in our hand, because it is depends upon the load. So only thing is we design the resistance with low resistance. So in UPDA they ask one question: the resistance of the field, series field winding is high, low, moderate, whatever may be. They call, we have a less value. It's a less value.
Sorry, that question is not clear.
Winding have a less value, and in general, it's about 0.5 ohm. Okay, number one. So first thing, we are say that it is a, we have a less resistance. And
so what,
less resistance. So we have a formula, R is equal to rho L by A. To reduce the resistance, we change the resistivity, length of the conductor, cross section of the conductor. We are using a copper conductor, so you forget about the rho. To reduce the R, the L is, sorry. So length of the conductor is reduced and area is increased. So that's why we have a thick wire. Thick wire represent, we have a higher. So we have a thin wire, we have a thick wire. If you have a thick wire, we have a area of the cross section is increased. If you have a thin wire, the area of the cross section is small. And we reduce the number of turns, because we reduce the length of the conductor. So few turns, the few turns represent the L is decreased. Is it?
So how is the question framed in UPD exam for this low resistance?
Yeah. Okay. So armature winding, sorry, field winding.
Hello. Excuse me, there's a question. Hello.
So few turns.
Hello, sir. Can you listen us?
Yeah. Small, thick wire.
Hello.
Represent.
Hello.
Area is increased.
Yes.
So in general, we have a less number of. We have about 0.5 ohm. So these three things they may ask in the UPDA exam. And similarly, this these things, these all the things is applicable for the ammeters. Let me discuss in the measurement topic.
Sir, can you listen to us? Hello.
Design with pewter thick wire.
Sir, are you?
Let me. In detail, we discuss in that measurement topic.
Sir, are you listening to us?
Now we're discussing about sound mount.
Hello, sir. Are you listening to us? There are people asking questions.
Hello.
Yes.
Yes, Mr. Mohini.
Can you hear me?
Listen to us. You have any questions?
Yes, sir.
Yes, I'm hearing you, but I have a question.
Yes.
Yes. I want to know in what format is this question framed in the. Okay. The question is: in what format do they frame this question in Series 1, the DC motors?
Hello.
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me?
Hello.
Hello.
I didn't hear your voice.
Hello. Yes, I can hear you. Can you hear me? I hear your voice. Okay. Now the question is: in what format do they frame this question on Series DC motors?
Hello. Okay,
I'll just send a message. I will just send a message just for me.
Just a minute.
Yes, in what format is the questions in Series 1 DC motors framed?
So you talked about low resistance, right, in the previous slide? So we want to know in UPDA exam how the question is framed.
Thank you very much. Did you get it?
Hello?
Yes, did you get it? We want to know in what format is the in what format is the question framed as regard the Series 1 DC motor? Can you hear me?
One second, please.
Okay. No worries. I'll just send a test.
One second, please.
1 minute. Just check the message. I'll send a message to you. What format?
Yes, tell me, sir. Now my voice is clear.
Okay, sir, the question is, in the previous slide, you explained about low resistance value being asked in the exam. Okay.
Yes.
So we want to know in the UPDA exam how this question is framed.
Okay. Let me, because...